So over here, we have the graph of the function y is equal to e to the x. Actually, let me make that clear. So that right over there is y is equal to e to the x. This, of course, is our x-axis. This is our y-axis. And so this blue area right over here, this blue area, we can denote that as the definite integral from 0 to 1 of e to the x dx. And let's say we know, in the future we'll learn how to actually come up with this number, but let's just say we know that that area is equal to e minus 1. So given that, I have these other three definite integrals. And what I encourage you to do is try to pause this video and try to evaluate what these three other definite integrals are using only this information and what we already know about definite integral properties. So I'm assuming that you have given a go at it. So you might first say, okay, let's see, e to the x plus 2. You might be tempted to kind of decompose this into the definite integral of e to the x dx plus the definite integral from 1 to 1. So that you could decompose this from 1 to 1 of e to the x dx plus 1 to 1 plus the definite integral from 1 to 1 of 2 dx. But you have to remember, if you're taking the definite integral where your bounds are the same, this is the definite integral from 1 to 1. This is going to be 0. This is going to be equal to 0. Once again, you could imagine that you're trying to find an area of something that has no width. You're not moving at all along. You have no width along the x-axis here. So that was pretty straightforward. From 1 to 1, your area is going to be 0. Now let's think through this one over here. So here my bounds are different. They are the same as this as these bounds right over here. So I guess that gives me a pretty good clue that maybe if I can break this up a little bit, especially if one of these is in the form of e to the x, I might be able to evaluate this definite integral. So let's do that. So the first thing I could do is I could break this up as the definite integral from 0 to 1 of 3 dx, and then I could say plus the definite integral from 0 to 1 of negative e to the x dx. And then I can take the negative. That negative is really just a negative 1. We saw that you could take that scaling factor out of the integral, so let's do that. So this is the same thing as the integral from 0 to 1, 3 dx minus the integral from 0 to 1, e to the x dx. Well, lucky for us, we already know what, let me do this in that same color. We already know what this, I have trouble changing colors. We already know what this right over here is. That's going to be equal to e minus 1. So if you subtract an e minus 1, you're going to get, actually let me just write it out so we don't get confused. We're going to subtract an e minus 1. And what is this going to be equal to? The definite integral from 0 to 1 of 3 dx. So that we just have to graph that to imagine it. So we are going from 0 to 1. And the function is at 1, 2, 3. I'm not doing it at the same scale. So the function looks like that. So this right over here is just this area. It's under the function f of x is equal to 3 from 0 to 1. So what's this area? Well, this is just our base. Our width is 1. Our height is 3. So this is just going to evaluate to 3. That's just going to be equal to 3. And so we get this is going to be equal to 3. And you're going to have minus e, just distributing the negative sign, and then plus 1. Plus 1. And then, of course, 3 plus 1 is going to be equal to 3 plus 1 is going to be equal to 4. So this is going to be equal to 4 minus 4 minus e. And we're done. We're able to solve, or I guess we say evaluate, or find the value of this definite integral using only integration properties and the value of this definite integral. Now what about this one over here? This one is interesting. Boy, I might have different bounds here. Definite integral from 2 to 3. Instead of an e to the x, I have an e to the x minus 2. And when you see something like this, especially if you're trying to evaluate this only with integration properties, the big thing that may or may not jump out at you is that e to the x minus 2 is shifted version of e to the x. It's shifted by 2 to the right. So let me draw that. So instead of this point being there, this point's going to be there. And so the curve is going to look something like, I'm going to draw my best attempt to do it. So it's going to be like there, It's going to be like there. So it's going to look something. I'm trying my best to just shift it over. So each of these, this is going to be shifted to right over here. So there you go. That's e to the x minus 2. So we're going from 2 to 3. And so what are the bounds now? The bounds are from 2 to 3. So we're going from this point right over here to 3, which is going to be over here. Just going to be over here. So if you take this point, you shift 1 and 2, you're going to get right over here. And what did we just do? We're thinking about this area right over here. Well, we shifted the curve over to the right by 2. This is the curve of e to the x minus 2. And we shifted the interval of that we're trying to find the area under, we shifted that by 2. So this is going to have the exact same area. I just shifted everything to the right by 2. So this area is also going to be e minus 1. In my mind, this one's a little bit tricky. You just have to realize that this is just a shifted version of that, and that we also shifted the two bounds to the right. And we already saw that in one of the integration property videos.